Close readers of Unsupervised Learning may hear the doorbell from Duke mid-recording. While he usually visits me evenings, he made a special afternoon stop, perhaps thanks to the appearance of Linda's Tesla. I hope you won't mind the minor interruption.
This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
Daddy, these people talk as much as you do.
Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. I am here with a very special guest today. I'm here with Linda Avey. Linda, I think a lot of the listeners are going to know who you are, but can you introduce yourself?
Sure. Hey, Razib. It's great to be here in Austin. I'm Linda Avey. I am the co-founder and CEO of Precisely. And prior to that, I was the co-founder and co-president of 23andMe.
So, why don't you tell us about yourself? Because I think, you're kind of a public figure. People might want to know a little bit about your background. And, I know a little bit about it. But I think, in terms of tech and biotech, you have kind of a unique background, to be frank.
Yeah. So, it was interesting how things were really starting to get rolling, especially in San Francisco back in the 80s. So I moved to San Francisco in 1985, and I was a little sales rep for a chromatography company, and Genentech was my account. That was, I represented my company and went to Genentech, and there were, I think, two buildings, although they were 1 and 4, and we were always like, we're a building 2 and 3. What is going on here? And it turned out they were, one of them was the animal facility. So they kept it hidden because they didn't want it to get, raided by people. But it was a really fascinating time in the evolution of biotech and the life sciences industry in general. And so one of the companies that was really cool, and a lot of my friends were going to work with them, it was Applied Biosystems. And back in those early days, they were the company that really was they owned the lion's share of DNA sequencing. Mm-hmm. And so that was really the early days of that company taking off, and the rest is history, right? Because that was really the platform that was used to sequence the genome. And I was kind of there in the thick of what was happening to get the genome project off the ground, which was not a simple feat, to get the funding for it and everything.
Yeah.
And then to see how Celera Genomics spun out of Applied Biosystems to compete with the government project. So that whole thing was taking place at a very interesting time and in my career. And I felt very lucky to kind of be there in the thick of all that.
Well, so, but obviously, you didn't come fully formed in California, in 1985. What's the backstory? How did you get to California? Where are you from?
Well, I'm originally actually from South Dakota. And the next thing people say is, I've never met anybody from South Dakota before. It is, it's kind of an unusual place to be from, but a really interesting place. And I actually grew up mostly in the Black Hills, the western part of the state, which has a lot of very intriguing American history, and especially how it affected the Sioux tribe and the natives that were living in the Black Hills. But I went to college there and I majored in biology. And back in that day, either you went to med school or graduate school. I landed in a job at UC Irvine. I got offered a position there. And so I went and worked as a staff research associate at UC Irvine, trying to figure out, am I going to go to graduate school or medical school? And luckily didn't end up doing either.
Yeah.
And ended up getting this position up in Northern California in San Francisco. So I moved up, and that's, as I was saying, I just sort of fell into what was happening in the industry at the time.
Well, I'm curious, I lived in California for a while too. So it's interesting how many people I met in California who barely ever left California. And obviously a lot of people come from all over the world to California. What do you think, as being someone from South Dakota, where I have met people from South Dakota, but not too many. It's not a very populous state. What were people's preconceptions about you, and how do you think that, to be frank, just looking at you, you're a white American woman. Okay, you're the type of person that is from California, but you're actually not from California. And so, did you have a lot of weird preconceptions that you had to kind of deal with?
Oh, in terms of how people perceived me?
As a Midwesterner, as someone from the Great Plains.
Well, the first thing is, everybody was like, are you from Michigan? Because apparently I had the accent of the upper Midwest, which I, of course, didn't realize at the time. But no, I think it was such a mixing bowl anyway. So you just end up talking to people and they're like, yeah, I'm from Illinois, I'm from Indiana. It's just such a nice gathering of people from a lot of different places.
So yeah.
I think there was a little bit of a bit of a bias, I would say, against somebody from a state like South Dakota.
Mm-hmm.
And that's only gotten worse now for political reasons.
Yeah.
Understandably.
Well, I mean, so when I think of South Dakota, I think of Mount Rushmore, the Black Hills, and Little House on the Prairie. Am I missing anything?
Only that it's way better than North Dakota. So.
Okay. Okay. That's fair.
That. Yeah.
So, you know, you arrive in California in the 80s. You got involved in some of this early stuff. You know, genomics as a field, I mean, as a term, it's a generation old, you know. As a field, it's a generation old. But in the early days, like, it was slow going. In terms of, you know, there were people who were wondering whether we could even map the human genome, whether it was technically feasible. What did you hear back in the day? Like, I mean, how did you guys feel? Did you think that this was going to go on for decades? Did you think it was going to finish soon? I got a sense that it kind of accelerated at the end and got done quicker than people were anticipating.
Well, it wasn't really done. You know, when Clinton brought in Craig Venter and what's his name? Head of the NIH.
Yeah, Francis Collins.
Yeah, Francis Collins. That, you know, they kind of forced that ceremony and the celebration, but it was just a draft. It wasn't done yet. And most people in the industry knew that it was sort of an artificial point of celebration. I think we all had hopes that it could move more quickly than it did at first. And that's why the Solera project really got off the ground, because it's like, we can do this in a faster way.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that book, The Genome Wars, that kind of goes through that story of these
Who was the author?
I'll have to look that up. Yeah, I don't remember. Yeah. But yeah, it's just a really great account. And what's so interesting to me is like the author goes through kind of what was going on in these two side-by-side projects, right? A lot of animosity, and we know the personalities involved, so that's not surprising. But what was really interesting to me is that the author was invited into the Solera meetings to hear the discussions going on, whereas I believe he was not allowed to go into the government-funded project. They were very closed off, mm-hmm. very private about what was going on, and weren't open like the Solera group was, which seems like it would be the opposite, that the public...
Yeah.
Publicly,
well, I mean, we're paying for it.
Exactly. And so there are tidbits like that that come out in that book that I find fascinating.
Yeah, and you've been on the quote-unquote private side for a while. And do you think, you know, obviously direct-to-consumer, and I want to get into, like, you know, 23andMe and the direct-to-consumer genomics, which you were instrumental in. But do you think, like, back in the 1990s, you know, I was a younger person back then. I'm not going to say how old or how young, but... I feel like the media depicted the NIH project as kind of the good guys and Solera as kind of the bad guys. Am I wrong in that?
No, I think, you know, partly Craig, he brings that on himself. You know, whether that's deserved or not, I think that's probably the origin of that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not surprising.
I mean, it was just it was the narrative back then, you know, in terms of like there was these public spirited people at the NIH. But ironically, my understanding and from what I've talked to, like without Solera, it probably would have taken a lot longer to get to the draft stage.
Without a doubt. But then again, Solera wouldn't have been able to do the, you know, the work if they didn't have the data coming out of the public project. So it was very synergistic. And mm-hmm. the two projects working together, even though they weren't maybe collaborating as well as they could have been, but I think that's why it got done as soon as it did, because mm-hmm. they had these sort of two competing things driving things. And, you know, that data coming out of the public organization really helped Solera do the assembly part of it, right?
So, yeah.
So it was very complimentary.
And can you actually, just for the listener, I think most listeners probably know what assembly is, but can you talk about real quickly what assembly is?
Yeah, so when you do shotgun sequencing, you just basically break it up and then sequence the bits. And then how those bits fit together is really a difficult part of that process. And so if you've got other data to use as sort of your reference, that's how you're able to then put those bits of sequence together in these longer chunks.
Yeah.
And that's really how the process worked. And so... it was just sort of the different strategies where Solera was doing shotgun and the government was doing a process that was slower, but mm-hmm. allowed them to come up with these longer reads, if you will.
Yeah.
And that's really what that made the difference in why Solera was able to go fast, get the government data, assemble, and then come up with these big chunks of DNA sequence from the genome.
Well, so in the media and in the culture, there was a lot of excitement with Bill Clinton and the announcement of the draft and all that stuff. How did it feel, like, closer to the action where you were? Like, did you guys feel as excited, or did you think this is a little overhyped? Because it is the draft, and just so the listeners know, there are papers, preprints coming out right now about, like, kind of actually completing the draft 20 years later,
yeah,
finally.
Exactly. So I think a lot of us were just a little bit burned out by that point, and it was sort of like it was a bit of a blip, and it seemed very much like a PR play. And you could just see, Francis Collins and Craig just sort of cringing a little bit when they were sort of forced to shake hands and be there with Clinton. So I think we knew the kind of that backstory. It's sort of like sausage, right? Mm-hmm. You don't want to watch it get made.
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, so that's done. And then was that when you applied to Applied Biosystems or?
At that point, I was actually at a company called Molecular Dynamics.
Okay.
And then had moved on. So my ABI days were actually before that.
Okay.
And then what was kind of fascinating then, just, you know, we get this draft sequence published, and then this company, Affymetrics, starts building gene chips against that, right? So
yes.
Once they've got that draft sequence, now they can go in and build these chips that are a much cheaper way to read the genome through identifying where are these differences in the genome. Because as everyone probably, your reader or your listeners probably all know that
SNPs.
It's, you know, it's... We're 99.5% the same. Where are we different? And then that becomes this really useful sort of template for us to study disease, right?
And can you talk about how many markers were in these early Affy chips?
Well, the early ones were like 10,000. It was, you know, it was really... And so then, Affymetrics decided to do a spin out called Perlagen. And Perlagen then was formed to kind of take this gene chip technology that Affymetrics had and utilize it and leverage it for large-scale studies.
Yeah.
And so I went to work there, and it was a fascinating company. They raised $100 million, and they resequenced. So they took that draft. They built massive piles of chips that just looked at every base that they could to see, is it one of four, right? And they resequenced 50 genomes. So,
which was a big deal then.
So it went from that to $2 million from whatever the estimate, $3 billion to the first
$3 billion
for
the first.
So now you use a different technology, and you go in and you start to look at, okay, where do we see the differences in these 50 genomes?
Yeah,
and then that created the basis for a hapmap, right?
Yeah,
a haplotype map that you could say, okay, we know the ancestry of these 50 genomes, and now we can start to map out, okay, where do we see these SNPs, or these single nucleotide polymorphisms, and how they start to map these different ethnic backgrounds or these different, you know, different
so
groups.
For the listener, I mean, the reason why whole genome sequencing and this sort of stuff is important is you can't get variation off like one or a couple of individuals. It's just, you know, you want a bunch of individuals, then you get the polymorphisms, which are, you know, on the order of, say, 100 million within a 3 billion base pair. And then the hapmap, as Linda was saying, there are different ethnic groups. The original hapmap had Northwest Europeans, Nigerians, Yoruba, and Chinese, which, you know, I mean, those are three
pretty
big.
Limited,
I mean, today, you know, we would be like, what? But I mean, back then, it was a big deal.
Well, it was the first step into being able to study and see the differences, because we know there are different health issues in different populations. And so now being able to map that to these genomes, but doing it with a chip base is where you want to take the SNPs that are representative of those populations. So then you can start to study and see, why is a disease more prevalent in one population versus another?
Yeah. And so, okay, like now I want to like kind of like move into, okay, like right before 23andMe, your ideas, because I think like, you know, from talking to you before, like this is kind of laying the seeds for like maybe your idea of starting this company. So can you talk about it, the genesis of it, your vision, your idea of starting 23andMe and why?
Yeah, so when I left Perlagen, where we were working, and I think we did probably the first genome-wide association study at GWAS in Parkinson's disease. And so that sort of plays into this origin story. So at Perlagen, we had this technology now to read the genome. We created and you asked about the chip. So at Perlagen, we developed the first genome-wide chip with 250,000 SNPs. So that came from all of that resequencing of 50 genomes, building our own internal in-house hapmap, and then picking the SNPs for this first genome-wide array, which was insane. And so now we've got these chips ready to go, and now we're like, okay, what are we going to do? What studies are we going to conduct? And my job was to go find large patient cohorts that we could get DNA from to put against these chips, right? We couldn't find any samples, and we couldn't make any headway, and it was frustrating. So our CEO, Brad Margus, ran an ad in Science on a Friday that was got DNA, and it was the really cheesy, instead of got milk, it was a face with the upper lip had a DNA molecule on it. It's really, really bad. Okay. And they were like, we hope the milk board doesn't come after us. But I think in the ad, it was either my email address or some, you know, alias. But I get one email from that ad on a Friday night from a guy at Mayo Clinic. And he's like, I'm here and I've got DNA from 300 people with Parkinson's and their healthy siblings. So it was a discordant SIB study design. And that's all we got. So we were like, we got to go for it. So we did that study, but we got funding from the Michael J. Fox Foundation because obviously they support research of Parkinson's. And that's how I ended up meeting Sergey Brin, one of the founders of Google.
And what year is this?
That would have been in 2004, I believe.
Okay. Wow.
So, think about that. Wasn't that long after the genome had been, that draft had been published.
Yeah.
And so all that work got done, and now we're suddenly in a position to be able to do a big study like this. And luckily, we found these samples from Demetrius Marigonori at Mayo. And that really was then sort of this thing that kicked off a lot of follow-on studies that got done. But obviously, it was underpowered. We didn't really discover anything in that study. But it was really this introduction I had to Sergey. And he had some really good questions about the design of the study. What's the p-value you use to make a genetic association? I mean, really smart questions. And so then I got it in my head that, I think one of the founders of Google is interested in genetics. And so that was one sort of kernel of an idea. And then I moved on and I actually went to Affymetrics. And I worked in their this group that was trying to identify large-scale studies that could be turned into diagnostics.
Mm-hmm.
So you need a large-scale study, kind of like what we were doing at Perlegen. But at Affymetrics, it was a bigger project and we had more funding to kind of support that. So I was working on, trying to find samples. And then I had this sense of, Google was literally down the street from us at Perlegen. And I kept then trying to get my connections into the Google team. And finally was able to get, I got introduced to the head of Google Health. And that's kind of what got the connection into that group.
Mm-hmm.
But then the other thing that happened is I went to a trade show, and I've told this story many times, and I'm walking through the little, the vendor hall, and I see this table where it says, get DNA from saliva. And I was like, what? That's not possible. And they had these little kits on the table, so I grabbed one. And this was when I was still at Perlegen, and I took it back to the lab, and I'm like, look, you guys, we could actually get DNA from saliva. And they're like, no way. And they're like, well, let's try it. Linda, you spit. So I was the guinea pig. They ran my sample. They were able to isolate my DNA from the saliva, and they ran it against one of the chips that we had in the lab. And then it was also in my head like, wow, my data is sitting on a computer somewhere in the lab. And it was just this feeling of, I really, really would love to have that data.
Well, this is the mid-2000s, right?
Yeah, this was, yeah, exactly. So that was the combination of, we can get DNA from saliva, and how cool to be able to get your own data, and then what could you learn from that? So then when I went to Affymetrics, I met with the CEO and I kind of told him about these ideas, and he's just like, go do it. Go start this company, this consumer genetics thing. I think it's a great idea and I'll support you and just get it off the ground.
Well, so at that point, there was family tree DNA, which was very, very small batch and kind of almost artisanal, let's be frank.
Yes.
Like, I think they were still using, they were still using the hammer. And they were using the hammer lab resources in Arizona. And so, okay, so consumer genetics, which is a thing now, tens of millions of people. But back then, I mean, I'm into genetics. So when I heard about 23andMe, I was excited. But like, what did people think? Like, wait, what?
Well, the reaction was binary. And I would say probably, if I had to give a number on it, I would say that 80% of people were super positive and excited. 20% were like, I will never do that. And that was always our response was, well, you don't have to. This is totally your choice. And I, you could see the relief sort of wash over people because you could tell they were struggling with, would I want to do this or not? And it's just like, no, you don't have to. It's only for people who want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was a good reaction to the fear some people had. And then doctors, I can't tell you how many times people said to me, patients are going to jump off bridges when they get their data. And I was like, where is this coming from?
Which has never happened.
No.
To my knowledge.
No, to my knowledge neither. But I finally think I figured out why doctors had that reaction. Because in medical school, the only genetics back then that they were really taught were about Huntington's. And
okay,
that's
which is,
really severe yeah. information for a person to learn. So now I could understand that you've got this dramatic thing that comes from genetics, and if that's all doctors really have in their heads, no wonder they're going to have that reaction. So it made sense.
Yeah, I mean, you know, to give some context here, Huntington's is a degenerative disease, and it's like you kind of freeze up, right?
Yeah, you just, I think, kind of get locked in your body.
And, yeah, and it, you know, it's progressive. You know, you can
and
have
it's
it.
It's inevitable if you've got the gene for it. I mean, it's and yeah. The thing is. Technically, we weren't even able to read the you know sort of this genetic marker for it
yeah.
with the SNP chips that we had at 23andMe.
Yeah, so it's a triplet.
It's a repeat disease.
Yeah,
and the more repeats you have, the sooner I think the onset.
Yeah, progression. Progression's a thing. So Huntington's is actually I think how Francis Collins kind of made his name with the original linkage studies in the early 1990s.
And cystic fibrosis too. I think.
Yeah, and so I mean it's one of those loci that's like super important for medical genetics. I mean, I'm assuming, like, honestly, like, we're not going to talk too much about CRISPR because, like, whatever, that's the future. But mm-hmm. I bet you CRISPR will be one of the diseases that targets because it's a big deal. It affects a non-trivial number of people.
Yeah, I don't know, though, with the way that because it's a repeat, I don't know if CRISPR can really actually. I don't know. I'm no expert on that. But
yeah,
it's a tough one.
Well, maybe a listener will. We'll get some feedback. So you basically your impression, and I think this is true. You know, when I have told people that I work in personal genetics, people I know from high school, they literally say scary.
Yeah.
Because that's what they know about genetics. But, you know, when you guys started 23andMe, you found something different in terms of what people were interested in. So, for example, you know, you guys started doing ancestry and genealogy. And can you talk about kind of like the you know, just the origins of that, because you've told me a little bit about it. It wasn't part of the plan, right?
Oh, ancestry was part
ancestry
of the plan.
Ancestry was. Okay.
Yeah. So we were, in fact, that was kind of the what we thought would be the good consumer angle. But, you know, telling someone about their background and all that for sure. That
yeah.
was definitely part of the plan. The part that we were a little mixed on in the early days was the health side. Like, what could
okay.
we really honestly and carefully tell people that would be accurate? And we had roaring debates in-house on how we present information, and we finally came up with what we thought was a good way to position it, where we had, you know, how strong are the genetics for this particular disease, you know, high, medium, low, and we had all kinds of ways to caveat that information, and we all had to come to agreement that this was the right format for the health reports. The thing that we didn't really anticipate was people finding relatives.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, the genealogy.
That was the part that was. And in fact, one of our engineers came to me and Anne and said, I've developed this algorithm where I can compare one person to everybody else in the database. And he'd actually run it and found relatives even in those early, early stages of the
yeah.
company where there weren't that many people in the database.
Yeah.
And I mean, I kind of still remember getting goosebumps like, oh, my God, this is going to be crazy.
Yeah.
And maybe not always a good thing, but we definitely have to launch
this. There's been whole books written about basically genetic genealogy and relatives and, you know, lost relatives and all this stuff. So it's transformed the culture in a way.
Yes.
And, like, you know, I think I can divulge this. Like, I mean, we have, like, my wife, she herself has found relatives, you know, people giving up for adoption and other things.
As has my husband's family.
Yeah.
I mean, we found out that his father, who's no longer with us, was only a half sibling with his sister.
Okay, I did not know that. Well, I guess everyone knows that now.
Yeah, everyone listening. Yeah,
but I mean, this is the world we live in, where it's, you know, there were all these secrets, and now the secrets are just kind of like, okay, like TikTok, like, you know, how long are the secrets going to last? Because the reality is everyone's going to be in the database.
Yeah,
and you know, I told my friend Rob Henderson, who's actually adopted, and he hasn't done the test yet, but I was like, oh, well, how are you going to feel when you get matches? And he said, well, why would you assume I'd get matches? And I'm just like, Rob, just do the math.
Right.
And he was shocked. So people don't understand that when they go to like Ancestry or 23andMe, these companies, there's enough people in there. You're going to get matches unless you're.
I mean, a lot of them are so, like mine, I think the closest I have, well, I have people I know, like first cousins in there, but the closest I get is like third cousin. And that even that's a little hard to figure out exactly how you're related to them. And those aren't surprising.
Yeah.
Or they at least they haven't been for me.
Yeah. I mean, I've had multiple friends who are adopted who go in there. And they, you know, I think I've told this story, but like I had like a friend and he heard a rumor, like, from the small town he's in that his dad, who was kind of a philanderer, had had another child, and so he wanted to get matched up with that guy. And so he goes into the database, and he gets a match with a 25% match.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but it's a woman. It's his stepdad's sister.
What?
So it turns out that his mom had an affair with his stepdad before...
Oh, wow.
His parents divorced, and he hates his stepdad.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, so that was awkward, and also, his stepdad's sister saw the match.
Oh, no.
And so this is like, okay, like, who tells who, and anyway, these are the sort of things that you have to deal with, and this came out of just kind of this engineer's, I mean, this was probably going to happen.
It was, I think, kind of
inevitable. It was
inevitable. Looking
but,
back at it
But
now,
I mean, 23andMe, I mean, basically, Ancestry just copied everything.
Yeah.
Let's be frank.
Yes.
Right? They
right.
Just, they took the relative matching. They took the Ancestry. They basically copied the whole feature set.
Yes.
Except for like, not the health, you know.
Well, they tried a little bit, but they're...
But they shut that down. Yeah.
They're shutting that down.
Yeah. And so, I mean, so back then, you had this idea about health and, you know, personal genomics and all this stuff, and then there was the issue with the FDA. It seems like that area of it has been a lot more I don't want to say fraught's like kind of like a generic term, but it's just been a lot more difficult to get traction on that as opposed to Ancestry and genealogy, whereas like these are the killer apps of personal genomics.
For sure, absolutely. And you know, it's not surprising because the health stuff too is a lot of it, you know, people don't really know what can I do with this information, right? It's a little unknown. And there are stories where people have gotten their health information and they've made changes to their lifestyle. And that's great. But that to me is that's where there's so much more work to be done. We need so much more data. And this is where I think full genome sequencing is going to be needed to take things to that next level.
Okay.
SNP chips are great and all, but they don't provide all of the information. And we're missing a lot, like... Some things that might be a rare mutation in a family, for instance, we're going to completely miss with the SNP chips. So it's a natural evolution to move to sequencing for sure.
Yeah. So for the listener, these SNP chips normally right now, I think, are like between 600,000 and 1.2 million markers. And so if you do whole genome sequencing, you'll find, you know, I don't know, you're going to be like on the order of tens of millions different from the reference. So a lot of that is not going to be in the arrays. And so, I mean, this is the vision and the dream. So I think initially your price point was $999.
That's right. Yeah.
How did you arrive
crazy.
At that price point? Just
well,
less than 1,000?
Well, partly, yeah, we wanted to be less than 1,000. But we, at that point, the chips were expensive and running them was expensive. So we weren't, there wasn't a lot of margin back at that price point. But
well,
we
I mean,
just knew we couldn't be... And Navigenics was charging way more.
Yeah.
And they claimed that they were running the big chips, but they weren't actually. They were running a smaller chip to power just those reports that they...
That's called. Shady.
Maybe I shouldn't have said this, but because one of our employees at 23andMe actually did Navigenics. This is all ancient history,
yeah,
so I can talk about it, right?
This sounds like Theranos level. I mean, come
well,
on.
Not really,
if
because...
If they're charging for, like, a big chip and they're running it on a small chip, like, what is going on here?
Right. So our employee then, because they were very, they had to match our sort of principles in terms of you can get your data if you ask for it. So our employee did it and then asked for the data, and it took forever for them. So they had to go run the big chip.
Oh.
That's our, again, this is just kind of speculative of what was going on, but I did kind of confirm that later on. That they were not necessarily running the big chips on all of their customers.
This is how Silicon Valley works, listener. No, just no, I mean, I understand why they would do it this way, but so the chips were super expensive. Weren't they like 60,000 markers initially? Or did
no,
you guys?
It was more than that. It was more actually. I think it was around a million.
A million? Okay. Yeah. So you guys start out with a million markers.
Or 600. It was.
It was 650.
Somewhere.
It was 650 or 500. 550. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So you guys start with that big marker set, and so Initially, it's super expensive. Were you guys surprised positively or negative about the uptake?
I don't think we were that surprised. We were, you know, we were hopeful that we'd get, and we did get some of the early adopters, and it was fun, and it was, you know, people probably who were in the Google network, but yeah, it was slow going in those early days. Not surprising. Who's going to pay $1,000?
Yeah. Crazy. Yeah. There's some people. So, and then, you use like Lily Mendel. Is that your daughter? Or is that you?
That's me.
That's you. Yeah. Okay. So you used yourself as a model. And like, what did you find out anything that was interesting?
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that was the most interesting was that I'm APOE3/4. Mm. So I have one of the four mutations that increases my risk for Alzheimer's.
Okay.
So, you know, I took that in, but then I also looked at my family history and have had grandmothers live to 100 who are never had any signs of Alzheimer's. So it to me, it was just an interesting data point, but it didn't affect me in any way other than that I pay a lot of attention now to Alzheimer's research.
Yeah.
But it's been very out there. I forget who the person was that they had that contest, remember, at the Snipedia guys.
Oh, yeah.
And they did that contest to see what you could tell about Lily Mendel's genome, and they ran that contest. I forget who won it, but they, you know, they went and dug through my genetics and found all this information. I mean,
that's all good.
Yeah,
you know, you find out more information is pretty good.
Yeah.
So, you know, right now, I mean, I feel like a lot of people would say that 23andMe created the market. It created kind of the general, I mean, created the template.
It was a category.
I mean, I can tell you, like, Embark, which does, like, the canine stuff, their color scheme is awful familiar, isn't it?
Actually, I hate to admit, my daughter just ran her dog against that.
Okay.
Which was fun.
Well, I'm just saying, like, in terms of the aesthetics, like, the general, just, like, what direct-to-consumer genomics is, 23andMe kind of set the standard, right?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
And so, I mean, in terms of, like, where we're at in 2021 compared to, like, what you were thinking in the mid-2000s, what have been, like, if you do, like, okay, what your expectations are, what your surprises are. Like, we've already talked about genealogy. Like, that wasn't part of the plan, and it became a huge thing.
Yeah.
You know? Like, what is the big top line, like, differences between what you expected and what's happened?
Well, I feel like we haven't made as much progress. I mean, and again, the whole reason to start this company really was, and that's why we ran the big chips, right? Because we could have done what Navigenics did. Just do a small chip,
get reports, cheaper,
get power the reports, done deal. But we were committed to this idea of doing genetics research. And so that was really the other big differentiator with 23andMe is that we started to put out these surveys to people. And at least in the early days, and I think Anne is saying that they're still getting like 80% of people to respond to the surveys, which is insane. And that really fuels the research that gets done on the back end. And that's really what led to these partnerships with pharma, that they've got, you know, $300 million came in from GSK, and there were Genentech and all these companies that partnered, because it's a massive data set now.
Mm-hmm.
But despite all of that, I still don't feel like we've really made the progress and the hope for this. And I do say that it's probably partly the data. You know, it's SNP data.
Yeah.
It doesn't give you rare mutations. You're missing all of that.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of the constant in our field of, but if only we had used this new technology, if only we had kind of had that at our disposal back in those early days, I think we would have made a lot more progress, to be honest. So it's kind of disappointing that we don't have more pharmacogenetic stories, right? That we don't have more information that comes into play in our healthcare system. It's just not there yet.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so like about 10% of Americans have done direct-to-consumer genomics, which is not a trivial uptake. Right?
No.
But I mean, I guess the issue is, like, you know, what's going to happen when 10% of Americans are whole genome sequenced, right? Right now we just have the SNP array data, and that's fine. And there's some, I mean, people know about the asparagus, you know, I mean, there's a lot of fun. Like, I feel like 23andMe has had a big cultural impact. Now, whether it's had an impact on medicine, that's a separate issue. And so I think that's the game breaker. There's a lot of money in medicine, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, I think, you know, if I were to assess, because I've, you know, like I've bought my kids, I got my kids in 2009, you know, for my current wife and myself, and like all my kids and my, okay, like I'm not going to lie, I'm a completist, like they're all on Ancestry, they're all on me, they're all everything, you know, because you never know, but So I have, like, you know, everybody on there, but, you know, I also think that, you know, there are certain areas in terms of genetic prediction where in 2021 we're still not there. And maybe that's just like a limitation of the models of science and genetics that we had in terms of common variant, common disease, which, you know, I think it's kind of like, and so this is the idea that there's a lot of common genetic variants around that are affecting the common diseases. And it may be that there's rare stuff, which is what you're talking about, Linda. Mm-hmm. And that's a much bigger deal. And we're going to get that with whole genome sequencing because that's the total absolute information. So I guess I'm saying, okay, personal genomics has a huge cultural impact, but it's still got some distance to go when it comes to the field of medicine. And so what are you seeing? You know, you've been involved in this for decades now, you know, and this is going to go on into the 21st century. So, you know, we are here when it comes to genomics, like in it's a cultural impact. What do you see for the next 10 years? Like, what's your future vision since you've been involved in driving this?
Well, I think also the thing we're realizing is that genetics is just one piece of the data that we need to be tracking. And I'm sure all of your listeners are well aware of what happened to Ubiome. But I think microbiome is one of these things that we have barely scratched the surface. Mm-hmm. And so now we start to look, okay, we've got genetics. We need epigenetics. We need microbiome. There are so many. It's always, human health is always way more complicated than we think.
Yeah.
And new things keep turning up. And I frankly just think our diets are probably the biggest issue in healthcare.
Yeah.
That genetics pales in comparison when you mm-hmm. think about diet and the impact it has on health. So I think we have way bigger fish to fry, to be completely honest. And okay. Genetics will always be a component of it, but I have to say I've kind of moved on. I'm kind of past the, you know, being so hyper focused on that and looking at the much bigger picture, looking at integrative health and systems biology approaches. Yeah. We just need to be way more comprehensive, and I think there are bigger things to tackle. Where genetics may, you know, and I know of Everly Well and what they're doing, and mm-hmm. I think that's great, but I think we've got to just meet this diet problem head on.
Yeah.
And you see these big corporations that sell empty calories, and it's like, how can we let this keep going?
Well, so even since the first draft of the human genome, our country has had issues with, like, increased obesity, especially in the younger cohorts.
Yes.
It's the numbers are pretty shocking. And then, you know, when I was a kid, there was the quote fat kid. But, you know, I got kids in elementary school, and I'm going to say that it's not singular anymore.
No.
Things have changed. We need to really, really hit this somehow because, you know, yeah, we can try to win the battle against cancer and all these other things. But there's all of these issues related to, like, lifestyle that are causing a morbidity drag on our culture. And healthcare is 25% of our economy, and it's going to continue, and it's going to increase, and it's going to get worse if we don't do something about that.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And so you think that we can, like, perhaps nudge it with technology? I mean, that's your vision.
Yeah, and we have to. And the medical system has to embrace the issues. And I think the pandemic has really been illustrative of this problem. So many people who are obese, unfortunately, were greatly impact much more than people who are not obese. And
yeah.
so that was a big aha moment, I think, for, mm-hmm. and the medical system needs to step up. But it's all also about choice, right? And we have all these choices, and we've got to figure out a way to encourage people to live healthier, to eat healthier and exercise. You know, it's just all the blah, blah, you know, stuff people probably don't want to hear, but what are there things? And I don't want to say legislation has to be a part of it, but maybe it does.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Or at least incentives.
Yeah, nudges, incentives. Like, I mean, there's ways we can enforce fasting on people. That's gonna, you know, we can't do that, right?
No.
But we can't continue to go in the current direction as a society and as a culture. It's not healthy. And, you know, I think we all understand it. And so, like, how do we figure it out? How do we resolve it? And, you know, from what you're saying is, you know, you think the future is going to be in kind of, like, allowing technology to help us be a better you know, healthier individual, healthier society, right?
Yeah, exactly. And in the medical system too. I think technology could really drive a lot of the things that, frankly, doctors are just too busy and too stretched to really be able to focus on. So mm-hmm. how can we implement technologies into healthcare that kind of take that load off of the doctor's plate? But mm-hmm. they know that, okay, the patient is hearing the right things about their diet, and we can track them on a more regular basis and give the patients the incentives that they need to stay on track. And we see that that works. Coaching works for people to mm-hmm. to lose weight and to live a healthier lifestyle.
Well, so, you know, the last question as we're closing out, I know that you have been, you know, thinking about health and medicine and stuff like that. I mean, what is your just view about American healthcare and the American medical system? Because I know you've been studying it. Like, I mean, what are the, I don't want to say pain points, but what are the weak points in it? Like, I mean, how would you, what do you think is going to happen in the next 10 years to make it better? Because I think that's what we want to hear.
Yeah, well, I think we're going to see technology implemented in ways we're not right now. And that's, again, something that one of the silver linings of the pandemic is that we've really opened up the ability to do telehealth and telemedicine. That's a huge step forward that now we should be able to leverage that. And what are some additional things that we can do to really, again, take the load off of the doctor's plate? This should not be foisted upon them. They already have way too much. So what are the routine things that we can automate for them and bring technology in to handle? And again, seeing the proof points of bots as coaches works. I mean, that's a proven model now. And how can we really implement that within the healthcare system mm-hmm. to really join technology with care teams and then also really help the patient on a more regular basis through technology? And I, you know, Apple is making some huge moves. I mean, they're really impressive what they're doing with the watch and really integrating technology into promoting a healthier lifestyle. So I applaud Apple. I think they're on the right track.
Well, I mean, so do you think people are going to be comfortable? Do you think the new generation is going to be comfortable with bots, with technology, with artificial intelligence? Because my understanding is that's always been kind of the limiter where people just, they want another human being, even though I think there's a fair amount of evidence that at the low level, you don't really need a human.
I think it's a mixture, right? You want to have the human at the right time and the right point, but there's so much that you can do with technology. And I do believe that it will be accepted and embraced, and we'll figure out what the right handoff is. Like, okay, this needs to go off to a person for some reason, and we'll figure out what those kind of pain points are. Mm-hmm. But it cannot be, we can't do it in our current system. We absolutely know that.
Okay. Well, Linda, thank you for coming on the show. I think you've, you know, given a lot of insight and information to the listeners who I think, you know, a lot of the listeners here are super interested in genetics. They've done direct to consumer genomics. So I think they'll be super excited to hear from you. And we're, you know, I think they've probably enjoyed this and, you know, hopefully they've been illuminated. And, you know, we're ending on an optimistic note. You know, I do think, like, look, we can't get that much more obese as a nation at this point. So hopefully, you know, as we go into the 2020s and even into the 2030s, we can look forward to technology making a better world. That's the hope. It's not like a guarantee. We need to make it happen. And I think that that's how I want to end on this show. So thank you.
Thank you, Razib.
This podcast for kids.